You were in Lesgotenga, is that, was that your village?
Lesgotenga, on the way to Fadengorma, in Niger anyway. Right on the main road, which evidently, after we left, has been paved.
The road is paved, that's hard to imagine, isn't it?
I remember in the dry season that the wind, I don't know, shifted or something or other. Anyway, all the dust and the dirt, when the trucks would come by, would come right into my place. Red, good red laterite dust.
So Lesgotenga is on the road.
Right on the road, at least it was then. Whether the actual road is still there, or they've made a new road to Fadengorma, and not to have that one paved, so it might actually be bypassed now. But I really don't know.
It's funny to be cut off by the bypass.
That's right, cut off. It sounds like somewhere around here.
In Lesgotenga, did you? What kind of house did you live in?
I think it was probably started the day we landed, because I didn't move until about 10 days or 2 weeks after our arrival. Made with mud bricks, but a European style, with a tin roof, three rooms, cement floor. I guess it had a little cement on the outside there, and tin windows sort of thing. It was a little compound of mud wall, little compound in there sort of. In one room for a shower stall, and one room for, I guess they expected to do cooking in the outside there, which turned into a tool shed for me.
How did you cook?
We had a bottle of gas, double burner hot plate, which was one of the luxuries, along with the Electrolux apartment size refrigerator from England, run by kerosene, little bitty ice cube trays. But it had to be just level, otherwise if it were tilted, you wouldn't get any ice cubes.
You'd get smoke.
That's right, you get smoke, right, exactly, out the
smoke.
Back.
Uh-huh. Well, what were you doing in Lesgotenga?
I was in well construction primarily, what, 9 months, I guess, out of the year. And in the off-season, first year, I set a person up building, first I made a big mud oven. I mean, I think it's probably still there. Because there was no fresh bread within, I don't know how many miles or kilometers radius. And I learned in Kupela how to build a mud oven, and then learned from somebody there how to make bread, you know, with a big enamel wash pan, would double as a wash pan, laundry pan, and knead the dough in there. And set somebody up to making the bread. He made it, I guess, every other day, every third day, and then sold it in the local markets. Walking to the market first, made a little box for him to carry, the locked box to carry the bread in, after some crates or whatever we'd gotten tools in from the United States. And over the course of, I guess, not quite a year, he made enough money to buy himself a bike. And the next thing I knew, he'd taken off for Ouagadougou, and they said that he had been or was employed by a bakery, and it was sort of like I couldn't believe this was happening, and I saw him sometime before I left, and indeed he had been, and the bakery was taken over by another person who ran it along with a brother or two brothers. I think it was about every day in some market, because the local markets there were only 3 days, or every 3 days, I guess. And but somewhere there was a market, and they had to, of course, collect the firewood and all that sort of thing. But it was quite thick, at least probably two mud bricks thick, and then we cemented on the outside to preserve it. We also built, which I learned to do, at least helped, a mud hut from scratch where we kept all the supplies and the flour and all that. And I was the initial investor, so to speak, coming up with the money for the first, 50 kilo sack of flour, which we get from Waga. And the first we used rock salt, that's all we had there, which you had to dissolve in warm water, and had to have the water at the right temperature for the yeast and all that sort of thing. Anyway, and then I was the treasurer, we kept the profits, and then after the first stuff was paid for, then of course the first time we had to save enough for two, my initial investment, then enough to buy the next supplies, and then after enough was saved for the next supplies, then that was profit for the guys. But And the oven, of course, it took, what, I guess 2-3 hours to heat it up to get the wood in there and then get it the coals down so you wouldn't burn the little bitty bread, French bread, a la French bread or whatever, call it. I'm going to call it baguettes. Baguettes, a little bitty one. So about five CFS francs a piece. But after they finished, of course, the oven was still quite hot, and I used to get peanuts and stick them on this bread pan and stick them in there about 3 minutes and have roasted peanuts, and always had a bag of peanuts or a basket of peanuts for the kids who were always in my house whenever I was there to a little snack on there. And the bread pans was kind of fun. We got a sheet of corrugated tin for roofing, and I cut it in, I guess, 4 quarters, and that was the bread pan, and where the little valleys were, that's where the little baguettes were placed. And they like little worms, and then they rose up with the yeast in there. They had to take a razor blade and slit them, whatever. Yeah, it looked pretty good. So at least every 3 days the first year, the area had fresh bread, whereas before we had to go to Kupela, and after the third day or so, or however long it took you to get back there, we got a little moldy at times. So
like a rock.
That was great, yeah, right. That was enjoyable.
Another story I remember, and I don't think you ever told me this, but didn't you do some road construction or bridge construction?
Right, okay, that was, if it wasn't the first summer, it was the second summer, that we built two bridges in a town. When it was dry season, no problem going through, not a Buffon, but a gully, whatever they call there anymore. But in the rainy season, it was just washed out, just to, you know. Now, whether they're still there or not, I don't know. But we got from the Cercle molds for making, rings, like culverts, mm-hmm. Which actually they use for buses, I guess, to sink down into a well. And we made, it had to be wide enough to fit a truck over it. That was the idea. I guess we had to make three of these for, like, one pipe, smaller bridge. Another one, I had a double pipe for the water to flow through. And then made them and cured them and all that, and had to, we took the molds off and had to cover them with grass mats and so forth and water them down every day to cure the concrete. And then we also made from hand concrete blocks. I got a mold from the local missionaries there, I forget the name of the town anymore, and had to mix the mortar just right, not too dry and not too wet, otherwise you'd raise the mold up and the thing would flop down, which we did. Many of them turned out that way, and just had to pack them again and to cure them, and I haven't probably made a couple hundred blocks that way, and put a foundation in and all that sort of thing. I know we had trouble after the first rainy season, and that some of it did wash out and we had to reinforce it. But after, of course, the second year, I don't know whether it's still there or not. Hopefully, if it needed to be repaired, it could have been repaired. But anyway, it provided that this town was able to get a truck in there during the rainy season, which it couldn't ordinarily. So, and I like construction, and so that was a good thing to do in the rainy season when you couldn't do any well construction.
Couldn't do wells.
Yeah.
Lesgotinga was a fairly isolated village in that it was miles from Kupela, miles from Father Ngurmo, sort of in
the not isolated in the sense that it wasn't on a main road, because it was on the main road between the two, but isolated from, say, a larger place.
It was on Bus.
Right, on Bus. There had been a regular stop for the, what was the bus called?
Trans-African,
right. As a matter of fact, there were ruins of a big hut that had been built
bus terminal,
and a well had been dug, a small diameter well right near the house that was built when I was there, and over the years, I don't know how long I've been there for, I got there, maybe 20 years, the laterite had gotten hard, except down the bottom where the water was, and it just created a huge cavity, and in the off time, I, along with a couple of people from Lesgotinga, actually cemented the well up and then made some small buses, which we sunk down in there and put a cover on it and all that. And so that well, hopefully, is still producing.
Still operating.
That somebody could use, right there near the main road. But actually, I didn't build a well from scratch in Lesgotinga. They had one, a good size one, built in 1958, I think it was. So 10 years, not quite 10 years before we got there, built by, I think, the Cercle. Mm-hmm. So they didn't really need a well. It was everybody else. It was about 8-mile radius, I guess, 8-mile radius that I worked.